I feel betrayed. I feel like my government has come and just kicked me in the teeth for no reason.
They're using hundreds of thousands of tax dollars that could be better spent prosecuting real criminals like rapists, robbers, drug dealers. Instead, they're using our resources to go after people who are just making reasonable use of the property. It's ridiculous.
It's a difficult thing to contemplate, but environmentalism has become one of the greatest threats to personal liberties, to private property rights, to free enterprise that we have ever seen in this country.
All of a sudden, they arrested my father. Maybe 12 federal agents came, literally kidnapped him from his place of business. I get a call at work saying, someone took your father. But it wasn't the regular police. It wasn't any agency we knew of.
We can either have the continuation of a free society, a society that operates under law, or a society gone berserk, where federal agents actually become the criminal element that destroys this country.
Earth Day 1970. The emergence of the organized environmental movement. The dawning of a green age in which environmentalism becomes a political and social force. In the following decades, the green movement becomes more organized, integrates into government, seizing control of environmental policies and governmental activism. The green movement becomes institutionalized. The results are that Congress and government agencies increasingly dictate lives with onerous and pervasive environmental regulations. These laws threaten America's free enterprise system. Under the guise of environmentalism, money and power are now concentrated. Ordinary people are fighting their government for control of their own property. Americans are jailed and private property is taken. How could this happen in our country? How could the simple desire for a healthy environment get turned into a freedom fight? How is it that this seemingly grassroots movement, which captured the hearts and minds of so many Americans, gets seized and twisted, turned into a powerful weapon of the financial elites and the monopolists? These are the questions this program will explore as you come with me and take a look at the real environmentalism as we go behind the green curtain. We all want clean air and water. We want nature to thrive. We also want to prosper and to enjoy the fruits of labor. But in order to be free, we must be able to use our property. Private property is at the heart of all of our other rights. The right to vote, to speak freely, to dissent, to worship. Simply put, without the right to use our property, we have no freedom. Today, however, our private property rights are being destroyed by environmental regulations and laws. And it's not our natural heritage that's being preserved. As we peer behind their green curtain, we'll see the truth. We'll see the green movement's methods, the financial elites who control them, and their ultimate goals.
What modern environmentalism has really become is the fact that it's driven by money. This grassroots movement that everybody loved in 1970 has lost its way, and it's become the tool of very large money interests and big foundations all over the world.
If the government owns all the land, if the government owns all the wealth, then the government doesn't need you or your vote. The government can operate independent of the will of the people.
Well, the system works like a communism. You buy it, you pay taxes, but you can't do nothing with it. It sounds like communism. I live with a communist. I run away from a communist, but now I see the other side of the picture. It looks just like a communist.
Ron Arnold is the executive vice president of the Center for the Defense of Free Enterprise in Bellevue, Washington.
Who writes environmental laws? Congress doesn't write those laws. Environmental groups write those laws, and then they go to Congress and get them passed with very expensive lobbying, with all kinds of support from their membership groups sending in letters and telegrams. They have a perfectly orchestrated machine. Once they get those laws in place, they go to courts, form test cases, then it's cast in concrete. And you get laws that begin to creep forward, like the Endangered Species Act, which started out as a perfectly wonderful way to save the big symbols of America, the bald eagle, the grizzly bear, things that everybody wanted to save. Then as time went on, the bureaucracy decided to build its own empire, and pretty soon they were saving a little bit of this and a little bit of that. And soon there were rules that were never written into the law, and now we have this enormous structure that Congress never wrote.
The environmental movement has grown enormously in the last 20 years. It started with, you know, the clean air, clean water.
Paul Kaminar is the executive legal director for the Washington Legal Foundation.
Now it's basically taken on a whole ecosystem type of an approach where the whole earth needs to be protected, that we have to protect not only the wildlife, but the habitat of the wildlife, and you need buffer zones to the habitat and buffer zones to the wetlands, and the buffer zones need buffer zones, and before you know it, they're regulating your backyard. It's just grown exponentially over the last 20 years, and there needs to be a limit put to this kind of nonsense.
I'd like for you to meet Marge and Raj Kruger. They bought a lot, and on that lot, they wanted to build their retirement home.
About 3 months before we were going to start building, Fish and Wildlife declared the golden cheek warbler, the black-capped vireo, and five cave invertebrates endangered. And as soon as they did that, they put a hold on all building on any lot or whatever that could possibly be habitat. And at the time, we were refused building permission. They didn't say that this was habitat. They just said it might be habitat. And as far as the city of Austin and a building permit was concerned, might be was as good as, hey, no way. And that was 4 years ago, and they still haven't let go. But we get to pay taxes on it. We never got an official notification of Fish and Wildlife that we have been caught up in their clutches. We found out just in the course of doing what we were planning to do. And we have never gotten any kind of notification from them that we have not initiated. We get back this mealy-mouthed letter that says we can't decide whether it's habitat or not. It might be or it might not be. But as long as it might be, no building permit.
It wasn't just us. They labeled habitat all of the lots on this street, something like 400 lots in this single development. 70 or 80 in the development right next to us, and I don't know how many in the rest of them. I went in 1 year to argue getting our property tax cut to a reasonable level for something we can't build on and we can't sell, and he's showing me screen after screen after screen with this little ES, ES, endangered species.
From our viewpoint, the property has been effectively taken from us and donated to the birds without any compensation to us. It might be worth it if it were spread over all society. But a few people who get trapped in this mess pay very greatly. And that's a great unfairness in the system.
The environmental movement doesn't act alone. They use their operatives inside the government and the large foundations in more than 12,000 groups all over the country to isolate, to divide and conquer, to take first small groups, small industries, vulnerable individuals, and apply a law, ratcheting it down, making it more strict, making it less possible to use your land, to use your own enterprise, to do with what's yours, what you want to do with it.
The close relationship between government and environmental groups is not just a revolving door of insider deals. It's deception as to purpose. It's the invasion of private lives. It's the seizure of private property. The environmental group, governmental foundation axis will do anything to achieve its real goals. Take one Sierra Club attorney as he cynically explains how the government and his organization distorts law to achieve their real agenda, going so far as to fabricate an endangered species.
The ultimate goal of litigation is to delay the harvest of old growth forests so as to give Congress a chance to provide specific statutory protection for those forests. That is the long-term goal. Until legislation is adopted which protects these forests, we need at least one surrogate, if you will, that will provide protection for the forest. As the strategy for protecting old growth matured, it appeared that wildlife would offer the most fruitful hunting grounds for a surrogate. Well, the northern spotted owl is the wildlife species of choice to act as a surrogate.
Often, government agency executives sit on the boards of environmental groups, move on to work for environmental groups, or were themselves environmental operatives at some time in their careers. Contrary to popular belief, big business is not the primary target of this environmental group, government, foundation, coalition. Today, it's average Americans, small and medium-sized businesses, farmers and ranchers, homeowners, you, who are the target of these predatory actions.
This is a house I left when the revolution broke out and come to this country. It was in 1956.
John Posguy is a mechanic who came to America in 1956, escaping the tyranny of the Soviet Army. He thought when he immigrated from Hungary, he had escaped the excesses of government. But when he saved up and bought a tract of land on which to build a small business, he found out that America was not the land of freedom he thought it was.
We never even knew what was going on originally. We had known that we bought a piece of property in 86. It was clean, light industrial property. It had no easements. It had no restrictions. I mean, we wouldn't buy it unless we were able to build on it. That was our initial thought, was we were going to put our truck repair business on this side of the street. So it was a dump yard. We had a lot of work, a lot of time invested. We cleaned it up. When it started to look good, we were ready to build. We went to the state. The state said, sure, you could build here. Just level it off. Put some topsoil down. Clean it up a little bit better. We did that. We had environmental impact studies saying that our streams were clean now. We could get started. Then all of a sudden, the Army Corps came in.
By cleaning up the vacant lot, which was a dump site, then preparing it for his building, the U.S. government, through the Army Corps of Engineers, decided John Podsguy was violating wetlands environmental regulations. Though he had state and local approval, John Podsguy had become, in the federal government's mind, a criminal. The government hired his neighbors to spy on him, to photograph, and to video him.
See that air conditioning window? Well, that's where they had the television camera to monitor us in that top window hole.
They surveyed us for maybe a month. They watched our activities. They watched the war. They watched what we did.
And also they got paid well for it, too.
Absolutely. They did their civic duty.
Yeah.
So they just come over here and they check our house, look everywhere, everything. And I asked them so many times, tell me what they want, what they're looking for. Because they check every door, everywhere, upstairs, downstairs, the cellar. And I says, you tell me what you want, I give it to you. And they just laugh at me. They don't even treat us like a person. And it was very painful.
You invest your life savings into a piece of property, and then, you know, the government comes out and says, it's not your property. I mean, you can own it, you can pay taxes on it, but you can't do anything on it unless we say so. And you ask them why. Give me a logical explanation. Would you like to buy the land from us? You have every right, just like anybody else. Come on out here and give me a fair offer. No, we don't want to buy it, but we don't want you to use it. We don't want you to have any value in it. I mean, how could you not fight that?
John Podsguy was tried in federal court. The jury shown pictures of wetlands with ducks on it, were not allowed to see the actual property that had no wetlands on it. Nevertheless, John Podsguy was convicted. He was fined $200,000 and remanded to Allenville Federal Penitentiary to serve a 3-year sentence. Carl Eby, who worked closely with the Podsguy case and who worked for the Department of Agriculture for 30 years, had this to say about the government's actions.
From the evidence that I have seen, it appears likely that both the Corps of Engineers and EPA did not adequately investigate the soils, the hydrology, and the vegetation on this site, that they made their decision without adequate data. John when he was represented in court, was not adequately represented, so that he didn't present the full evidence. His side didn't present the full evidence. But I think the regulators have a responsibility, that's the Corps and EPA, to seek the truth and to bring that out, not to go forward and deliberately try to catch a citizen violating the law, but to find out what the truth is. And I don't think that was done.
We've had expert after expert after expert come out and testify that we do not have these possible criteria to meet a wetland, but currently there is no law, there is no, there's nothing but our word against the federal government. And when you get into a federal court, you're not going to win.
So John Podsky has paid fines, taxes, and even served his time in prison. He still can't use his property.
They believe the Constitution is an antiquated document, and it's gone with the wind. And basically, they have free reign. They can tell you what to do with your property, and you have to do it. If you won't do it, they'll come out and do it to you. And they will do it. I mean, this is living proof. They built us a one-acre ditch. They put my father in jail, brought out contractors, dug a hole, put the dirt from here to there, and now they made the property useless for environmentalists, useless for us. And yet our neighbors over there are running a junkyard, same land, same elevation, same dirt. Where's the justification in that? This was the time when they were supposed to enjoy their life, or they were supposed to be able to retire, and now they can't. I mean, it's basically a catastrophe, and I don't think they can stop fighting, because, you know, this is a freedom fight, and I believe they'll win, but it's just too many years.
I hope one day they let us free. They gave us back our land that we could do what we like to do. You know?
Unfortunately, the Podsky case is not the exception. All too often we see case after case after case where you have the U.S. attorney and the EPA going after the little guy, going after people like Old C. Mills in Florida, who put 19 loads of clean building sand on a quarter acre lot, the kind of sand that my kid plays in the backyard, not because there was any damage in the environment, because he dared defy the EPA and the Corps of Engineers and reasonably use their property. Not a single fish, bird, or sea lion was killed in the Podsky case, the O.C. Mills case, the Bill Allen case. I can name you case after case after case. And yet the prosecutors want to get a quick indictment, want to get a quick conviction, so they can say, look, we're going after so-called water polluters. That's nonsense.
John Podsky was a sacrificial victim. He and many other average Americans are used by the environmental groups as the so-called proof that the system is working. In this manner, they can hide the true agenda of the environmental elite. And this agenda, the persecution of the little guy, the rights of private property being eaten upon, is not about the environment being saved. It's about the environment being stolen. It's being stolen by the very people who control government at its highest levels.
Pine Creek became established primarily as a cattle ranch, and for many, many years they have produced beef for the American public. And if a person goes back and looks at the amount of beef that's been produced over the years, it's a phenomenal amount of poundage and runs into millions and millions and millions of dollars worth of product for the American people.
Wayne Hage was a Nevada rancher who once made a significant contribution to the local and national economy.
These corrals that you see here were the site of just a tremendous amount of ongoing activity, livestock activity. There were literally thousands and thousands of head of cattle that went through these corrals every year. When we were forced to shut down this ranching operation as a result of the pressures put on us by federal government agencies, primarily the Forest Service, it took roughly $1 million annually out of the local economy.
Environmental laws enforced by the Bureau of Land Management and the U.S. Forest Service have put Rancher Hage out of business. But when we look behind the green curtain, we see the proof of what's really behind the environmental movement's agenda.
It's really kind of sad to walk through here at the present time and see these facilities standing here essentially deteriorating. The reason why it's sad is because this is repeated literally all over the western United States, where one of the most basic and vital industries, literally one of the backbone industries of the West, is being decimated by the combined activities of the environmentalists working with the United States Forest Service and the Bureau of Land Management to destroy the livelihood of a tremendous amount of hard-working Americans, and at the same time destroying a large segment of the economy that has a direct and very negative impact on the entire populace of the country. It's really a very sad thing to see.
Could Wayne Hage be overstating his case? Consider this. In the early to mid-90s, the Nature Conservancy, the largest environmental group in the country, and backed by the Rockefeller Brothers Fund and a host of other large foundations of the financial elite, inspected 400 properties daily and was purchasing over 1,000 acres per day. Most properties are posted for quick sale back to the federal agencies at enormous profits. In fact, sales are often forced by getting a federal agency to threaten environmental action, forcing the owner to sell to the Nature Conservancy at a reduced value.
Why are they using the land management agencies such as the Forest Service, BLM, working in conjunction with the non-government organizations such as the National Wildlife Federation, Sierra Club, the Natural Resources Defense Council, to take private property without compensation? Why are they doing that? In other words, why do they want to nationalize these lands? I think to answer that question, you have to ask the question also, why have they wanted to nationalize lands in other nations? Whether that was in Germany in the 1920s and 30s, whether it was in communist China, whether it was in communist Russia. What is the reason for nationalizing land? In a free society, the individual is sovereign, the individual owns the land, and the government must pay attention to what the individual has to say. So really this attempt to nationalize land in this country, which has been going on for 100 years and is intensifying now, is nothing more than the age-old attempt, which has always been with us, of a few people attempting to control all the wealth and all the power to the exclusion of the masses.
Fully one-third of the United States is owned by the government, more than any other Western democratic nation. In the West, more than 50% of all land is federally owned. And more land is coming increasingly under government ownership through regulation and control, prevention of use by lawful owners, or outright confiscation. Very powerful forces are at work behind this green curtain. A healthy environment is no longer at the heart of this issue. It's power, it's control.
Big money interests and foundations, very big money foundations, have essentially taken over the programs, the projects, the direction of the environmental movement, and are using it as a tool for their own purposes.
Ron Arnold has been studying this issue since the early 70s. In the book, Trashing the Economy, written with his associate, Alan Gottlieb, the major environmental foundations and their contributors are detailed. Arnold tells us it's the foundations and large corporate empires that now drive the major groups in the environmental movement.
Their agenda is one of power and money. Power and money can get you anything you want. You will find that a lot of the money that goes into these environmental groups that you know by name, the Nature Conservancy is only one, the World Wildlife Fund, the Sierra Club, many of these groups are getting stupendous amounts of money from big money foundations that have their own agendas for social change.
Consider the statement from a prominent National Wildlife Federation attorney as quoted in the Washington Post. Property rights do not include the right to squeeze every dollar of profit out of every square inch, only the right to a reasonable return. The Post then reports that private property owners' complaints about environmental laws are a cover for fat cats to radically reinterpret the Constitution. The National Wildlife Federation had a 1993 annual budget of $83 million. ARCO, DuPont, Seba Geigy, and oh yes, the Washington Post were some of their big business contributors. Jay Hare, National Wildlife Federation's executive director at that time, had a salary and benefits package approaching $300,000. Just who are the fat cats?
What about groups like the Wilderness Society? Did you know that with all of the contributions that they get from donors, people that they reach through direct mail, $15 here, $20 there, they have a multi-million dollar investment portfolio, and in those investments are common stocks. They own 400 shares of Caterpillar that makes bulldozers. They own shares of Cummins Diesel, which makes engines for bulldozers. Why? Some of the things that we find happening is simple real estate deals. You find organizations with the most respected names, such as the Nature Conservancy, and as a matter of fact, they're simply very large, very elite, very rich real estate brokerages. They do all kinds of things in the name of the environment. Essentially, it adds up to they buy land, they sell it to the federal government. What you know is only what they tell you in the magazine ads. Conservation through private action. It sounds great. In fact, in 1993, they sold $73 million worth of private land to the federal government, simply nationalizing private land. They do other things too, in the way of real estate deals. It's called mitigation, where someone needs to develop property and there happens to be some kind of sensitive area. It might be an endangered species, might be a wetland. The developer finds they suddenly need some kind of mitigation property. If they want to develop an acre, they have to give some government agency 20 acres. Who sells it to them? The Nature Conservancy, of course. It's a real estate business.
Glenna Brozig is the property rights analyst for the Conservative Coalition.
Here in Texas, just recently, Exxon was fined for an oil spill, and the state collected $130,000 from Exxon, turned around and gave the money to the Nature Conservancy to buy an island for a rookery, a bird preserve. They've used state money that was supposed to be used for oil spill cleanups and given it to a nonprofit land trust to buy a bird rookery.
One of the most preposterous sounding things that's ever happened in the environmental movement is a big money foundation called CERDNA, based in New York, that's been giving money to environmental groups in California to go out and teach activists how to stop timber sales by filing protests on federal lands. So they shut down all of the timber harvest on a number of national forests in the Sierra in California, put a number of mills out of work, put a number of sawmill workers out of work, and then we discovered through some research that this very foundation owns a whole huge 75,000 acres of timberlands of its own in that same area, and it realized $2 million worth of income after it had done that, stopping the income elsewhere, making the income for itself.
The environmentalists always win. They get settlements of hundreds of thousands of dollars in the cases. Therefore, taxpayers are basically making a contribution to environmental organizations and then stuck with the results of the lawsuit. Two examples of that. One is the shrimping industry in Texas. The environmental group has filed suit to shut down the shrimping industry. This is the second time they've done that. According to one official in the shrimping industry, they settled the lawsuit last time for $800,000 and walked away. And they're back again. Her suggestion is they just need money. The other example is the Edwards Aquifer lawsuit filed by the Sierra Club. What they did was sue the federal government for failing to protect endangered species in the aquifer, and the result of that has been creating huge water markets and limiting the rights of landowners, and in the process, the Sierra Club ended up with hundreds of thousands of dollars of taxpayer money once again in attorney's fees and other damages in these suits.
Imagine the already bloated government joining forces with the most powerful super lobby on Capitol Hill. Money Magazine stated that in 1991, environmental groups took in $2.5 billion. As a movement, these groups are like no other in number of laws they've written, number of court cases they have won, and number of regulations they have imposed. They are private, and yet their activities shape broad public policy. Many are closely connected to the most powerful corporations in the world and America's most elite family foundations. And most are subsidized by exemption from income tax obligations. They are the only important power center in American life not controlled by an internal canon of ethics or by government regulation.
The people who are driving it most to make things tough on the average person are the Rockefeller Family Fund, the Pew Charitable Trusts, the W. Alton Jones Foundation, the MacArthur Foundation, the Bullitt Foundation, names that perhaps the average American has never heard of. Some of them are quite famous. But there is a huge amount of money in each one of those foundations, and they use it very deliberately, targeted to specific programs to stop the use of resources here, to stop the use of private property there. It all adds up to a virtually dictatorial grip on your personal rights.
The Rockefellers, who chartered one of the oldest private foundations in the U.S., saw its birth from the Standard Oil Trust, one of the most monopolistic, anti-union, anti-free enterprise companies in the history of the country, and certainly very generous. But the Rockefeller generosity is not so charitable as it may seem in all cases. John D. Rockefeller coveted the Jackson Hole area at the turn of the century. Since he didn't want the locals to know what he was doing, he went on a program of buying up the area through shell corporations. He then donated the land to the federal government for a park, but he managed to grab the concessions for hotels and amusements. He also owned property near the area. Its value soared. The success of this operation was recreated in Colonial Williamsburg, where the Rockefellers controlled the 6 hotels in the park. This pattern of donating certain areas was reproduced all over the country. That, in one simple methodology, is one way these foundations and financial backers work today. It's just business.
You'll find that the environmental movement is funded by big money interests, international interests, whose primary goal is the ultimate control of all the world's wealth in the hands of a very few.
We have considered ourselves to be environmentalists, or at least sympathizers. We contributed to several groups like the Nature Conservancy and the Sierra Club, and we've tried to do our bit for recycling and such matters as that. We feel like environmentalism has turned around and bit us.
Drawn blood, too.
Yeah.
If they could do this to one person, they can do it to more. And they have already done it to so many families. And all it takes is like 10 family farmers here and 10 there and 10 there. And before you know it, the federal government has all the land.
If we are to remain free, we must have the right to own and use our own property. We want to use good common sense and good science to achieve our economic and environmental goals also. But the most important thing is we must act. And we must act because we can win. All across the country right now, states are passing laws to protect private property rights. In Texas, for example, private property owners held demonstrations that helped scare the environmentalists and bolster legislators into passing laws that would stop further control. But we must never give up the fight, because environmentalists are going to fight us back.
In the summer of 1994, an unlikely group of protesters marched up Congress Avenue to the steps of the Capitol. Farmers and ranchers from all over central Texas, numbering 3,000 to 4,000, drove their tractors and rode their horses and pulled hay wagons and marched and chanted all the way up Congress Avenue because they were furious and they were frightened about what the federal government was proposing to do to 20 million acres of private property in central Texas. They gathered on the steps of the Capitol and they demanded change, and because of the pressure that they exerted on the politicians who were then running for election, change happened.
This is a democracy. Voting is how you get your wants out in the open. And when a government in a democracy gets enough people angry, they become the ex-government, legally at the ballot box.
Be careful. The government is certainly not your friend. If you chop your tree down in your backyard or plow your land, you may be violating an environmental law. The message is to make sure your congressman, congressperson, and local officials know that you're not going to take this kind of over-prosecution of the environmental laws, and that you want some sanity brought back here. But my warning is, watch out, because the prosecutors are out there to make an example out of you.
The power of one is remarkable. It starts with you, but you have to organize. You have to find friends. You have to find people of like mind. Once you've organized, think of all the things you can do. You can easily influence your congressman by telephone calls, by visits, by letters. You can influence public opinion by writing letters to the editor. And once you have your own group organized, then you will find that there is a whole network of people who have organized like you to defend private property rights, to defend individual liberties. Network with them. Do exactly what the environmental movement itself did to become strong and powerful. And you can combine to become strong and powerful for personal liberties, for freedom, for property rights.
A call to your state representative or your state senator asking for them to intervene in a proposed action on the federal level is not out of the question. It's very important, and it's right and proper to do that.
There's a difference between the environment and environmentalism. An environmentalist doesn't necessarily speak for the environment. You have to make sure you know the difference between those two. Look the next time they knock on your door to see how many investments they have. Once they want your $25, will they actually use that for the programs they say? Are those programs actually going to do anyone any good? Or are they going to invest it in a big stock portfolio that you don't know about? Ask.
If it's so important to preserve the environment, then it should be done honestly. Pay honestly for what you want to preserve. Don't expect some innocent landholder who just got caught in the crunch to pay money for what you want, and it becomes a double unfairness when it doesn't even do that much good for what you're trying to preserve.
It's not a bad thing to question the environmental movement. It's a very valid question, because we have learned that the environmentalists don't necessarily show great concern for the environment.
The challenge we face in this country today is the same challenge that has always been with us. From the days of the American Revolution, we were fighting the same battle, the battle of nationalization as opposed to federalism. Those who wanted to make this a totalitarian society compared to those who wanted to see a free society.
What's at stake in the environmental movement? Not the natural world of flora and fauna, but private property, free markets, democratic society, freedom itself. That's what's at stake. And unless we start having a real debate with honest science and honest dialogue, we'll see more and more ordinary people fighting government for control of their own property rights and for economic survival. I'm here in Central Texas, one of the hotbeds of the environmental movement. The people around here are nice folks and kids just like you and me. But they're victims of the environmental movement, too. Every day, they're told that their health and safety are threatened. They're sold on the idea that there are benefits of the government controlling their property. But the true benefactors of this deception don't live around here. This is the age-old story, the few who want to control the many. They want it all for themselves. And this is the true nature of the financial elite. This is what's really behind the green curtain. If we continue to sit idly by, then this green curtain will resemble the iron curtain that still haunts us to this day. If we truly want to save the world, then the light of freedom must be allowed to shine over us all and destroy the green curtain before it's too late.